So at some point in your life, you may have come across a cartoon version that attempts to depict the process of human evolution. These cartoons typically lay out a series of figures, starting from something that looks an awful lot like a modern-day chimpanzee, and then progressing through a series of cartoons that follow our species' purported history through time. So you see the origins of bipedal walking, maybe the beginnings of tool use, and sometimes by the end of it, in you know, satirical versions, you'll see a picture of, you know, someone walking around looking at their cell phone, or a programmer hunched over at a desk. These cartoons are usually meant as commentary. They're not meant to be serious renditions of human evolutionary history, but they do promote a major misunderstanding about how humans and other species actually evolved. So we didn't actually evolve from chimpanzees, monkeys, or other non-human primates, and there's never been a serious evolutionary biologist who's made that argument. So in fact, although this classical cartoon image implies that millions of years have passed along the bottom of these figures, that can't possibly be true. Chimpanzees, like the one at the very beginning of the series, still are found on Earth today, along with the fully modern human seen at the end of the series. In fact, modern-day chimps never co-resided with early hominins like Lucy, so they should come at the end, not the beginning. To understand why, it's useful to think about a different metaphor, actually the one that evolutionary biologists have been relying on since at least the time of Darwin. That metaphor is one of the tree, where the tips of the tree, the tips of our branches, are meant to represent the current endpoints of evolutionary process, such as the species that are living on Earth today. The branches that connect the tips describe how those species are related going backwards in time. Chimpanzees, humans, and other modern primates are tips. And because chimps and bonobos are the closest living relatives of humans today, they are the tips that come from very recent branching events. Repeated patterns of branch growth and then bifurcation, that's where one branch splits into two, can be used to describe the entire history of life on Earth, actually, as shown in some really beautiful classical drawings by early biologists like Ernst Haeckel. Our lineage, the animals, and then the vertebrates, and then the primates nested within them, can be thought as one set of the terminal branches of that much larger tree. After each split, each branch of the tree grows independently. That means it evolves independently over time, because individuals who belong to that branch no longer exchange genes, that is, interbreed, with individuals that belong on separate branches. How do we know where to put different species on the tree? That is, how do we know which animals are more closely related in time and which ones are much more distantly related because their branches diverged a long time ago? Well, one important way to do this is to use data from DNA sequences, and that's the way that most biologists do so today. Because groups of individuals only start evolving independently, their branches only start growing independently after their splits, species that split a long time ago will have more different DNA sequences than species that split very recently. For example, we know that chimpanzees are more closely related to humans than gorillas are to humans, and chimpanzees, gorillas, and humans together are more distant, are more closely related to each other than they are to other primate species like the African and Asian monkeys. This pattern is actually spelled out directly in our genomes. So human and chimp genomes are about 99% similar. That is, if you were walking along a set of DNA letters, A's, C's, T's, and G's, you'd have to go on average 99 letters between one copy of a human genome and one copy of a chimpanzee genome before you found a difference. When we compare gorilla genomes and human genomes, we get to about 98% similarity. So they're just a little bit more different from one another than humans are to chimpanzees. And if we go to baboons, a monkey species that I study, the similarity becomes something like 94%. So we can order those levels of similarity in order to understand the branching order of different parts of the tree. So that difference doesn't sound like a lot, but it actually is at the DNA base pair, that is the individual DNA letter level. There are about 3 billion base pairs of DNA in a single copy of the human genome. So when we think about a 1% difference between humans and chimpanzees, what that actually translates to is about 30 million differences at individual letters across the genome. By comparison, if we think about two copies of the human genome, one for me and one for you, for instance, the differences are about one in every 1,000 instead of one in every 100. That means that we are all, unsurprisingly, much, much, much more closely related to each other than any one of us is to another non-human primate. It also means that we all shared a common ancestor very recently back in time. So the tree is therefore one of the most important ways that evolutionary biologists and anthropologists think about the evolutionary process. But some of you may have had an experience walking through a forest or through a park or outside in your yard and noticed that tree branches do bifurcate. They do split into two, but every once in a while, you'll see branches that actually grow back together again. It turns out that that kind of process also has a parallel in human evolution. To understand how we know this, imagine a thought experiment that was posed by two anthropologists, Strauss and Cave, about 60 years ago. So Strauss and Cave were interested in Neanderthals, and they were particularly interested in the shape of the body, the skeleton of Neanderthals. And they said, wow, these extinct relatives of humans, these other very modern human-like individuals who used to live on our planet, they were pretty similar to us. Similar enough that they said if you bathed the Neanderthal, if you shaved the Neanderthal, if you put them in modern clothing and then stuck them on the New York subway, probably they'd get no more looks than any other person who happened to step on the subway. So that may in fact be true, but think about if an entire subway car or a series of subway cars were filled with Neanderthals. Then that might start getting some different looks. So that's the sort of big clue that led genomics researchers to realize that there may actually have been some intermixing of genomes after humans split from other closely related human-like groups. So specifically, while in most regions of the genome, people are very closely related to each other, that is, the sequences in their DNA are very, very similar, in some regions of the genome, there are stretches of DNA sequence that look weirdly different when compared to sequences from other people. If that were just a couple of letters, like a single Neanderthal on a subway, maybe that wouldn't stand out. But when those stretches start to get long, they start sticking out like a sore thumb. Once the human genome was sequenced and researchers started looking in detail at sequences from different people and comparing them back to this sort of reference, they started finding more and more cases of these kinds of molecular sore thumbs. They found that, one, they weren't very common. If you looked at the genome of any individual person, these stretches were pretty rare. They also found that those sorts of stretches, any single one of them, were really at really low frequency in any given population. But interestingly, they seemed to be a lot more common in people of European ancestry than they were in people of, say, African ancestry. And all of those clues together pointed to a potential explanation. Interbreeding, recontact of separate branches of the tree between the ancestors of modern humans in Europe and other archaic hominins when we both still existed on the planet. And it specifically suggested contact with the Neanderthals, who were an archaic hominin group that overlapped with the ancestors of modern Europeans in the Middle East and in Europe until about 30 or 40,000 years ago. So since then, people working in very advanced, clean labs where they can sequence very, very old DNA have actually successfully assembled the entire genomes of some of these archaic humans, and they confirm the hypothesis. Those weird stretches of DNA look like they match very, very well to Neanderthal DNA. Even more, we've been able to discover populations that we didn't know about except through ancient DNA evidence, including the elusive Denisovans, which we now knew interbred with the ancestors of modern Asians and Oceanian populations. We now think, in fact, it's likely that every living human today actually has a mosaic genome which carries little stretches of DNA from other archaic hominins that no longer live on this earth. These inherited segments may even affect what we look like and where we live today. For example, people who can successfully live in very high altitude environments in the Himalayas, like modern Tibetan populations, may be able to do so because they inherited a very special chunk of DNA from Denisovans that allow them to persist in really low oxygen environments. We also have some evidence that chunks of our DNA circulating in modern human populations that actually originally came from Neanderthals may help explain why some people are more prone to certain types of autoimmune diseases or certain types of mood disorders than others. So interestingly, lots of other primates that we study now on Earth also show patterns of intermixing after their branches diverge. So these new results from humans and from ancient DNA studies actually emphasize the continuity between our species' evolutionary history and the evolutionary processes that affect other animals, including our close living relatives. So the tree metaphor remains a really powerful one for understanding the evolutionary process. The recent research simply emphasizes that not only should we think about the process of bifurcation and independent evolution, but also allow for the possibility that sometimes those branches start moving in independent directions, but sometimes also recontact each other, at least for a short period of time in evolution. And in fact, those processes can be really important in understanding why we are the way we are today.
Thank you.